Thanks for tuning in to the TV Pet Show. I'm Kathy Covey, your host. Today we're going to the birds, specifically cockatiels, budgies, finches, doves, lovebirds, macaws, and cockatoos. Birds are the third most popular pet in the U.S. With me today is Kelly Ballance, behavior and training consultant, as well as the practice manager for the Avian Medical Center in Lake Oswego. Thanks for coming, Kelly.
Thanks for having
me. And who do you have with you?
This is Pistol, and he's a 3-year-old green cheek conure. And this is Scooter, a 33-year-old yellow-naped Amazon. Hi.
Wow. So, first of all, why would anybody want a bird as a pet?
Oh, they're lots of fun. They're lots of fun. And, you know, your dog is never going to whistle back at you like your bird will. So.
And how long do they live? You said that Scooter was already 33 years old.
Right. So Scooter's probably going to get into his 50s. And Pistol here will probably get into his 30s, but it really depends on the species of bird that you're talking about.
What is the long-lived bird?
The macaws probably live the longest as far as what people, those are the really big ones with the long tails, as far as birds that people commonly have as pets. And we have had one in the practice that is verified over 100 years old.
Wow.
Yeah, 3 generations of the same family.
So you really have to prepare if you're gonna get a bird.
I would recommend
For the lifespan of the bird.
Yes.
Wow. Okay, so when you're thinking about getting a pet bird, what kind of housing? I mean, when you have a dog or a cat, it's pretty intrinsic. You know, you have a leash, you walk your dog, you have a litter box, you have your cat.
Sure.
So what type of housing do you need for a bird?
Well, birds, we generally have 2 spaces that they're gonna be in, 3 technically. The cage, which you wanna get as big as you possibly can, because that's their house, their bedroom. That's where they're gonna go when they're not out.
Okay.
Then they really need a play stand. They really need to be able to get out of that cage and go somewhere. So a play stand that could be moved from one area to another, or one that's attached to the ceiling in your main living space. And then the third place that bird is gonna be is on you, so.
As evident by Pistol being on you. And this would be an example of a play stand?
This is one style play stand, yes.
Okay, and you've got the toys that they would interact with. We've got a whole bunch of different kinds of toys that they will interact with. And because I understand that birds are quite intelligent.
They are quite intelligent, yes.
So, is this to call you? The little bell that they...
What's so funny is when he's in the mood, he actually puts his head up underneath that and wears it like a hat.
Yeah. I guess your dog won't... won't do that at all.
Probably not. No, and that might be a good thing. I think I'd be disturbed if my beagle had a bell on his head. But yeah, it's normal for a bird to play with their toys like that.
So birds will get along with other birds. These birds seem to be okay in each other's company.
Yes, but notice they're significantly far away from each other as far as birds are concerned. And it's always something you want to do supervised. Birds will hurt, injure another bird.
Ooh, so okay.
Yeah.
And what about dogs or cats?
You know, it depends on the dog or cat, obviously. But that's an interaction that should always be supervised.
Okay. So you have a dog.
I do.
And you can have birds with the dog.
I do. I have a toddler as well. I don't know why the whole mix works, but it does.
Wonderful. Well, what else should somebody know if they're thinking about bringing a bird into their family as a pet?
Sure, the expenses are up there. The veterinary costs are significant, and sometimes they're much higher than they can be for a dog or a cat. You really want to work with a veterinarian that has got experience with birds, and a lot of it. It doesn't translate well, dog and cat medicine to birds. They're definitely a different animal. And then the expenses get bigger as a bird gets bigger.
Okay.
So the larger the bird, the more toys they're gonna need, the more space they're gonna need, the more food that they're gonna need. That sort of thing.
And can you bring him down here for just a second? This Pistol.
Thank you. How about a step up? Oh, I'd like a gentle one. Thank you.
And
hi.
Pistol and Scooter are both, their wings are trimmed. And why do you do that? I mean, obviously for this setting right here, we don't want them flying up into the rafters of the studio.
You know, a lot of homes don't really have the safety measures in place to have a flighted bird. Which is too bad because they are so much healthier when they get to fly. Every part of their system is built for that sort of motion of their wings going back and forth. It even affects their digestive tract. However, you know, if you've got kitchens that they can fly into, ceiling fans, windows, the door can be left open, and it's heartbreaking to lose your feathered friend. Most people don't teach their birds to come when you call them. although it certainly can be done. So, yeah. Hi, do you mind?
Great. Well, we're gonna delve a little deeper into birds in just a second.
Hi, Barbara Heidenreich here from Good Bird Inc. for KT with a tip to help you train your parrot. A lot of people are dealing with parrot behavior problems, and one of the ones we see pretty frequently is screaming for attention. Now, if your parrot is screaming for attention, there are things you can do to address this behavior problem. The first thing to do is to stop reinforcing screaming. This means whenever your bird makes a sound you don't like, don't run into the room, don't try to cover his cage, or shut the door in the room, because the first thing that happens is you walk in the room and he thinks screaming works. Instead, what you want to do is ignore screaming and reinforce something else that will work. If your bird says hello or rings a bell, those are great things that you can reinforce. You are a pretty bird! You're such a pretty bird! And your bird will learn that those sounds get your attention instead of screaming.
So, how can you help somebody make the right choice in bringing a bird into their family as a pet?
Well, the first thing I would say is do lots of research. We're dealing with many different species of birds. It's not just like a different breed of dog. And some of them live substantially longer than others. So that would be one of the first things that I would think about. And
where would you get the research? Where does somebody go to get some good information if they're looking at adding a bird to the family?
Well, our website is a great place to go, which is avianmedicalcenter.net. We've kind of gone through all the links and just given you the good ones. There's lots of places to get birds, and some of those are kind of the great places to get more information about that particular bird.
And where would that be to go to actually find a bird? I see the smaller birds at the big box pet stores.
Sure, but there's lots of birds available for adoption too. Things just didn't work out in their old home. Sometimes people get sick and they can't keep them. Sometimes they have behavior challenges. But there's lots of birds looking for homes right now, and there's lots of rescue organizations in our area. There's lots of rescue organizations nationwide.
Okay.
Animal shelters very frequently have birds these days. So there's a lot of them out there, and that is probably where I would say go first and find the bird that fits you as an individual. Like, you may get set on the species that you're really interested in. Like, I have to have an umbrella cockatoo. But you want to make sure that you get the right individual for you. It's a long-term commitment. You know,
well,
these
yes.
birds, 50 to 100 years, 30 for these little ones. Canaries and parakeets can live, you know, 10 to 15 years. That's a long time. So finding a bird that really likes you, kind of as you are, and that you're able to read their body language really well, it really helps for a long-term good relationship.
So if you're going to a shelter, now I know Bonnie L. Hayes, Washington County Animal Services, they don't have birds.
Sure.
Cat adoption team doesn't have birds. I believe the Oregon Humane Society will sometimes have birds.
Sure.
Do they have staff there that would be trained, or should you come in knowing what you want and how you're gonna proceed forward before you just walk in and say, hey, I want a bird?
I think having a really good idea of what kind of environment you can offer a bird is really gonna help that person help you make a good match. They're obviously gonna be more familiar with that individual bird than you are, but knowing what you can offer, what your resources are, what your tolerance for noise is, what your tolerance for mess is, how much experience you have in reading bird body language, those things are all things to kind of have before you go.
Great. Yeah, I've noticed that Scooter's not the tidiest.
No, and you know what? That is one peanut. That's one. He's found a way to make that confetti from one peanut. Yeah, it's helpful. You know, in the environments where they come from, which is all over the world, but most of them live in trees. They're arboreal, so the stuff that they're munching on falls down to the forest floor, helps the entire ecosystem. They just try to recreate that in your home.
So where would a bird like Scooter or Pistol come from in the wild?
In the wild, these guys are both from South America, different parts of South America.
Now, how can you tell if you've got a bird that was born in captivity, raised in captivity, as opposed to one that has come out of that environment directly?
Right. Well, back in the day, we had bands. They were usually round and not closed all the way, and they would be stamped with the port of entry, the airport that they came in, but it's not foolproof. A lot of those birds, the bands have been removed, and it's really hard to tell. We're not supposed to be importing birds anymore, so mm-hmm. the chances of your bird being hatched here, raised here, are pretty high, except in some of the older lived species, which still could be. We still have wild-caught birds that come in as clients pretty regularly.
Great. Well, wonderful. So is there anything else that somebody should know? Because we'll talk about behavior in just a second, but is there anything anybody else should know about picking the right bird for their household?
Right. I would really spend a lot of time with the individual that you're interested in. I would also try and get as much experience with that species as possible before you bring them home.
And how would somebody do that?
Well, go visit the stores, go visit the shelters, and tell yourself, I'm not taking this bird home right now, which is easier said than done. But they can be really, you know, they're priced to a point where it should be hard to be an impulse buy, but mm-hmm. if you're out there, you're ready and you're looking, the first bird that makes googly eyes at you is coming home with you, and sometimes that's not the best fit, so.
Great. Well, we'll talk about behavior in just a minute.
Great.
Merry-go-round is a super soft kitty who enjoys being petted gently and talked to softly. Cuddling in your lap is her favorite thing. She would prefer a quiet adults-only home. If you're looking for a quiet, cuddly sweetheart, this girl will fill the bill. Come meet her at the Cat Adoption Team.
So now that somebody has a bird as a pet, how can we help them create a positive relationship and a positive environment for that bird?
Well, a lot of it is being able to read their body language. Though they can talk, that's not generally how they're communicating with us. They communicate with us by shifts in their weight, by where their feather position is, by whether their iris, whether the pupils opening and closing, which is easy to see on a bird like Scooter. So one of those things, biting, is really common, and it doesn't have to be. You know, once I started using positive reinforcement training, I've probably been bit maybe once a year since 2005.
How do you do the positive reinforcement with a bird?
Well, it's giving them something that they want for doing something that I want. And it's just like clicker training a dog. And a lot of it is not asking them to do things that they don't want to do, and then instead setting up the environment so that they choose to do what you're asking them to do.
So I've noticed with Pistol, we've been trying to get him down here, you know, onto this little stand all day long, and he just does not want to be up there.
Yeah, there's not as much value in being on that perch as there is up here. They like to be up high. It's not a dominance thing. It has everything to do with that's a better launch site if they decide they want to go somewhere else. So the birds being able to fly really influences their behavior to a huge extent in ways that it can't possibly influence what happens between you and a dog or you and a cat. So knowing what they're gonna do before they do it, they telegraph these things with their body language. For instance, Scooter is a little bit afraid right now, and we can tell because they're shivering right between the lower part of his abdomen. Mm-hmm. And if I put my hand up there, the chances of him offering to step up are pretty slim. So if I continue, even though the bird is leaning away from me and shivering, I'm gonna get nailed. It's their only way of telling us no. And so often they have to yell it at us, and that's a pretty, and yelling is a metaphorical term, but you know, please, 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 you're not listening to what I'm asking you, and I'm gonna bite you because that makes your hand go away. So biting is really their last chance of asserting themselves. And so often it happens because we've pushed the limit too far. But if we instead set up the environment so they want to do mm-hmm. what we're asking, so say I was to stand up and offer him a Fig Newton or a goldfish cracker and said, hey, you can have this if you step up for me, I'll get the behavior that I want without having to force the bird to get it.
And you did mention metaphorically those screaming, but birds will scream, and that is something that a lot of people, a behavior that people don't like. How can you either get past that, or is that something you can't get past?
There's lots of ways to get around it. The crux of it is, why is that bird yelling? What is that bird getting out of it when they yell? So often what happens is a bird will yell and the person will answer them back. Well, that's fine for the first couple times. But then if the bird starts yelling and you keep answering them back every time, they're really just using that like a telephone. Hey, I'm going to call Kathy, and I'm just going to do it with this blood-curdling, glass-shattering scream that the neighbors can hear 2 miles down the road. So one of the first things that I ask is, what happens right after the bird does the behavior? When the bird is screaming, what are they getting out of it? What's the outcome? What's the purpose? And if we're giving them attention, then we find a different way to give them attention.
So the scream could be them wanting to get your attention, you reward it, just like rewarding bad behavior.
Exactly. So these animals are capable of making all sorts of noises. What if they said your name? What if they made kissy noises? What if they whistled at you? And that was your cue to give them what they want. So you whistle, I'll come running.
Or purr. I've heard
purr,
Scooter
yes,
actually make purr like a cat.
Yes,
he has purred like a cat.
But the thing is that if there's more value in behaving the way we want them to, so making nice quiet noises, playing independently with their toys, stepping up when we ask them to, if there's more value for the bird in doing that, that's the behavior you're gonna get. They're really, the world is what's in it for me. And if you can get in the bird's head and see really what is his function, what's the purpose of this behavior, what's he getting out of it, and then replace it with something else, your behavior problems go away. So
in the end, what do you tell people when they come to you and say, Kelly, I really want to get a bird? I mean, it sounds like it's something really, it's not as easy as getting a dog or a cat,
right,
from your local shelter,
sure,
and incorporating. I think a lot of us are intrinsically knowledgeable about how to deal with a dog or a cat as a pet. And
sure,
the resources seem to be just right there, mm-hmm, on what to do. And you know, our friends have dogs and cats. Honestly, I know two people, and you're one of them, my friends that have birds. My other friend, Renee, has lovebirds.
Sure.
So What do you tell people in the end when they're I think a bird, Scooter looks really cute, I love that he makes noises, and you can teach him to say something, that kind of intrigues
sure
me. What would you say?
I'm going to ask some questions about themselves and try and fit the species that I know into the life that's going to work for them right now. And then I'm really looking for somebody too who has either that commitment that no matter what happens in their life, they're going to stick with this animal. Because these guys live, 50 years. That's literally a lifetime.
It is.
Are you going to be able to take them with you? Are you a college student? Maybe you need to look at the birds who don't live as long, because that's a commitment that you can offer right now.
And those
now
would be what? Little finches, maybe?
Finches are great. Canaries are great. Some of the really great birds that I love for people to really begin their experience with are cockatiels and parakeets. And it's not just because they're smaller, although that definitely helps.
Mm-hmm.
But their body language is so easy for people who don't have any experience to read. The cockatiel very quickly moves away from you. The budgie very quickly moves away from mm-hmm you. And that's where okay, I need to stop. I need to give them a reason to come to me. Maybe some millet on my hand will help. So
it sounds to me like a lot of these behavior issues that people, complain about with the birds, the biting and definitely the screaming, comes from us.
Exactly.
Pushing the bird in a way that the bird is telling us not to, but
right,
it's just being wise to the bird sign.
Right. And that learning their body language is probably the biggest thing that you can do to have a good positive relationship with them. But so much of the problems come because we're not willing to change what we have, even though it's very clear that the bird needs that. So,
wow. People should really think about it before they bring a bird into
their
home.
I think so. I think they can make great pets. Obviously, I have one, but a lot of thought went into it. I wanted to make sure it was going to be a bird that was going to be able to grow up with my son, that my husband would be able to handle. His body language is very clear. He's also very tolerant and patient with me because we've built up this very trusting relationship in which every chance I get, I say, hey, hanging out with me is the best thing ever. Here's a goldfish cracker. It's like coming over to your house and saying, hey, Kathy, here's $1,000. I'm going to leave now. Good. I get a dinner invitation from that, right?
Wonderful. Yes, you would.
Okay.
Yes, you would. So, wonderful. Well, I appreciate you bringing Pistol and Scooter down for us to meet.
Thanks for having us.
I'm Dr. Nicole Putney, and Sparky and I are here with your pet health tip of the week. Keeping an eye on your pet's health is very important. Watching for things like increases or decreases in appetite, thirst, energy, urination, and defecation can all be clues to bring to your veterinarian if something else is going on. You can also keep an eye on them by doing a quick physical examination, just by looking at their eyes, gently lifting their lips to see how their teeth are looking. Pets often get dental disease. Looking inside their ears for any redness or discharge. Sparky's ears look very nice. And then looking under their fur and feeling for any lumps or bumps, scabs, or anything else that might be bothering them. So just a quick once over, once a week, can prevent a lot of problems from occurring in your pets.
When you choose a bird as a pet, you'll have a smart and long-lived companion. Take time to become familiar with your bird species needs and how you can create an enriching environment for your pet. For more details about this show or any of the other past pet shows, go to catadoptionteam.org/petshow. I'm Kathy Covey, and we'll see you next time.